I'm Lynda Kinkade. Welcome to CNN Newsroom. Ahead this hour, a warning that the coronavirus is not going to go away anytime soon. That's according to the director of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control. And it comes as cases continue to rise. Also, the humanitarian crisis along the Syrian-Turkish border is getting worse. Thousands, hundreds of thousands of people are trying to flee the fighting and seeking refuge from freezing temperatures. We're going to hear from them. And the U.S. Attorney General telling his boss to lay off the tweets. How does President Donald Trump react to this very public criticism? China has revealed that the health workers on the front lines battling the coronavirus are actually contracting the virus in alarming numbers. More than 1,700 have now been infected. Six of those have died. Overall, we have seen another spike in the total number of confirmed cases. There are now more than 64,000 worldwide, with nearly 1,400 people succumbing to the virus, most of them in mainland China. CNN spoke to the director of the U.S. Centers for Disease Control, who warns we could be dealing with this deadly strain for the foreseeable future.
And this virus is probably with us beyond this season or beyond this year, and I think eventually the virus will find a foothold and we will get community-based transmission, and you can start to think of it in a sense like seasonal flu. And the only difference is we don't understand this virus.
CNN's David Culver joins us live from Beijing. You have, of course, been on the front lines covering this story from the very beginning, David, and it is shocking to hear the numbers of people on the front lines, health workers infected with this virus. You've also been speaking to young families, including a family of a one-year-old child who had the virus. It must be certainly tough times for them.
It is, and it's tough to see the images, but I guess that's the one glimmer of hope in all of this, Lynda, is that we connected with them as they were leaving a Beijing hospital. The entire family had contracted the virus. They actually got it from extended family who visited from Hubei, the epicenter of all of this, came into town, and it passed along from one person to another. Fortunately, they're all doing fine, and they were able to be discharged. And the doctor even pointed out as we were there that it looks as though the numbers are becoming fewer and fewer of patients who are in his unit in particular. He was speaking anecdotally from what his experience was. But to your point, as far as the medical workers who are on the front lines, it is something that we have heard from them directly, nurses and doctors in Wuhan, in Hubei province, who have said, look, their biggest frustration from the start has been the lack of medical supplies, the lack of the face masks, the hazmat suits, the goggles. And initially, many of them acknowledged they didn't know what they were dealing with this virus. And so they were trying to treat patients as they normally would, and yet unknowingly having it transmit to them. I mean, one nurse early on had told us that at least 30 of her colleagues in the same hospital had been infected with the virus. Just incredible numbers. And now these are all being confirmed from the highest level, from the National Health Commission. This is the first time they've released this type of data specifically related to healthcare workers. We know 1,716 of them have been infected. Of that, six of them have died. And we actually knew one of them who died, a doctor, Dr. Li Wenliang. He became very well known here, a hero of sorts, because he was one who early on tried to sound the alarm in seeing what he thought was a SARS-like illness that was going around. He ended up getting reprimanded by local police in Wuhan. But eventually, before he passed away, he was vindicated by the Supreme Court, who said essentially the Wuhan police were out of line to have reprimanded him at all. But these numbers are unfortunately likely to go up too, even though they're getting the resources now finally to the front lines, the medical supplies in particular, Lynda. We do know that for some folks, it's just coming too late.
Yeah, sadly, it is. David Culver for us in Beijing. Thank you. We will speak to you again very soon. Well, Japan is reporting seven new cases of the coronavirus today, that bringing the total to 257 cases there. But despite fears of the virus spreading, Olympic officials say the Summer Games are on track to start in July. And just off the Japanese coast, we know some passengers on the quarantined cruise ship, the Diamond Princess, have been allowed to leave early. Our Will Ripley explains.
Hi, Lynda. For the first time since the quarantine of the Diamond Princess cruise ship here in Yokohama, a small group of passengers who have tested negative for coronavirus have been allowed to disembark. Just 11 of them, and they all fit very specific criteria. They're all under the age of 80, and they have to test negative for coronavirus and either have some other pre-existing condition or be in one of those interior cabins that have been, you know, basically feeling like a prison cell for the passengers who've had to sit almost 24/7, with the exception of being allowed outside every few days for about an hour. So this small group has now disembarked, and they are now being moved to quarantine facilities under the supervision of the Japanese government. Of course, there are plenty of other passengers on the ship who would love to get off, but for the time being, they have to stay put. There's also questions about what is going to happen if Japan does move forward with possible plans to test everybody on board the ship for the novel coronavirus. CNN has learned that Japan is operating under the assumption that for the peace of mind of passengers and the people in the communities that they live in, that everybody who gets off the boat is going to have to get a coronavirus test before they can disembark. And that raises questions about whether people will actually be able to leave when the quarantine is scheduled to end at 7 a.m. local time on the 19th. That's next week. The reason for that is Japan's limited testing capability. We know that Japan currently can only process about 300 test kits per day. They're trying to more than triple that capacity, but that will not happen until the day before the quarantine is scheduled to end. Those are unanswered questions that we frankly don't know what's going to happen, and neither do passengers, which continues to be a source of frustration. Japan's vice health minister was on the boat today thanking passengers for their patience. Passengers have all been given iPhones with health monitoring apps, and of course, crew members say they're doing whatever they can to try to keep people comfortable, keep them sane as the quarantine period continues here in Yokohama. Japan is reporting more cases of coronavirus that are not connected to the cruise ship. This is a big deal for Japan, which of course just months from now is preparing for the Tokyo 2020 Summer Games. The IOC held a press conference in Tokyo assuring the world that the games will go on as scheduled, but there are obvious questions about what kind of impact coronavirus is going to have on Japan's most important sporting event in decades. Lynda?
All right, well, Ripley, thanks so much for that update. Well, parts of the fashion industry is already feeling the impact of this coronavirus outbreak. CNN business correspondent Clare Sebastian joins us now live from Trenton, New Jersey, in a wedding dress shop. And clearly, the fact that it's impacting a dress shop there in Jersey shows that the supply chain right along from China, where they've closed a lot of factories, is being felt.
Absolutely, Lynda. This is Mon Cherie Bridal, which is a big wedding and prom dress wholesaler here in New Jersey. This facility right now, you can see around me, has about 35,000 dresses, wedding and prom dresses, but 35,000 is nowhere near what they would usually have. They have seen some serious disruption because of this coronavirus outbreak. And I spoke to the CEO, Steve Lang. He told me exactly what's going on right now.
Situation is, of our 45 factories, 13 of which make wedding gowns and the remainder do colored dresses like prom dresses and mother of the bride, half of them are back to work. The other half are waiting for their factories to be cleared and disinfected. But it isn't just the factories, it's the supply, the entire supply chain. So you have fabric mills, you have trucking, you have air freight. All of these issues are impacted in the entire supply chain.
As you hear, Lynda, it's not just the factories, it's the mills, it's the freight. Everything is impacted along the supply chain. You can see behind me some of the empty racks here. If it wasn't for the coronavirus, they would be filled with product. The company has not had a shipment yet, even though half of their factories are back up and running. They do expect one next week. But meanwhile, they're telling their customers, we can't do rush orders, we can't do custom. You're just going to have to live with what we've got. And they say they've got about 2 months inventory worth in this facility, so they're okay for the moment. But they just don't know what's going to happen. And that's what we're hearing across a number of different businesses. There's a lot of uncertainty out there. They are having to sort of talk to customers and make contingency plans.